demarcation in the interest of public order, the role of the district magistrate needs to be clearly differentiated from the role of the police commissioner. The reiteration by the Supreme Court in the Shaheen Bagh case of the right to protest within reasonable restrictions helps in understanding the breakdown of public order in Delhi over a 3-month period. There are two perspectives explaining the 16,000 calls to the police, 3,501 on one day, registration of 751 cases, 53 deaths, and destruction of property of over 20 crore, and the initial charge sheet running into 17,000 pages against 15 people. The police commissioner, responding to criticism of partisanship, rightly pointed out that criminal justice system, within its inherent checks and balances, be allowed to work. The other perspective is that community-wide protest is not itself a crime, and Delhi police having magisterial power under the Criminal Procedure Code to take preventive action failed to maintain public order. The public policy issue, as the alleged Sofia encounter underlines, is that such delegation confuses powers with roles. So the first distinction between independent actions for which no political clearance is needed by the district magistrate to maintain public order and by the police to investigate crime and make arrest was ignored. So second, maintaining public order requires the district magistrate to make hard choices between life and property to check violence. Though any death opens the door to an inquiry, there is no justification for lack of effective police action. Third comes, the district magistrate is expected to consider protest as legitimate leveraging governmental action to prevent others exploiting the grievance. In Delhi, the police did not distinguish between wider political support and violence caused by a few. And now comes riots essentially result from failure to maintain public order. The sequence of related events, spread of chakka jam and police action in restricting or ceding space are a case study of how public figures intervene to incite violence, changing the nature of a peaceful protest. Absence of immediate arrest leads to a riot, and dithering on ordering firing results in its spread. Now comes court's distinction concept. The Supreme Court has made a distinction between law and order relating to individual crime and public order. Pertaining to a community at large, the top court has also emphasized that the two terms are not interchangeable. The two concepts have different objectives and legal standards. Law and order consist of the analysis made by police of the situation in an area and their commitment to firm action and penalties under criminal law. So now public order is a duty imposed on the district magistrate to assess whether it is necessary to rush to the spot where law and order has been breached to prevent violence spreading and ease tension. The National Security Advisor, substituting for the district magistrate, did just this after riots in Northeast Delhi and in getting the Tablighi Jamaat headquarters vacated. The district magistrate's role is important in exceptional situations, for example, to prevent a breach of peace at a particular place, as in Gargi College, and also for grievance redress, as in Shaheen Bagh. If an official is allotted a dual role to both keep in place law and order and maintain public order, this could lead to the displacement of one goal in favor of the other. As was witnessed in Jamia Millia Islamia, community implications of the religious gatherings in Nizamuddin and preventing violence in Northeast Delhi. The Supreme Court has formulated certain guidelines and rules when it comes to these distinct duties. The first concerns the degree and extent of the reach of an act on society. Some disgruntled and agitated people going on vandalizing spree affect public order only when they affect a particular community as a whole. In Ram Manohar Lohia versus the state of Bihar in 1965, the Supreme Court held that in the case of public order, the community or the public at large have to be affected by a particular action as it embraces more of the community than law and order. which affects only a few individuals, the Delhi police did not make this distinction when a mass of unruly outsiders entered colleges, creating panic. Second, in the Madhu Limai case, the bench reiterated that the emergency must be sudden and the consequences sufficiently grave for an imposition of restrictions, extension of a restriction over a larger territorial area or for a longer duration requires a relatively higher justification and calibrated response. Third, in Anuradha Vasin versus Union of India, the Supreme Court held that the prohibitive orders should not prevent legitimate expression of opinion, a grievance or exercise of democratic rights. Specific restrictions have to be tailored to the goal, nature and stage of the emergency requiring the adoption of at least restrictive measure. So moving to the next case, it's Al Danish Rain versus State of NCT of Delhi. The High Court directed the setting up of an oversight mechanism to periodically review the exercise of magisterial powers by Delhi Police. The Supreme Court in a PIL is examining whether police officers can act as magistrates in certain cases. The Supreme Court has also specifically recognized the importance of the assessment of the role of the district magistrate distinct from that of the police. So the next point comes, will policy